Hi, this is Martha Reeves of Martha and the Vandellas. Martha Lavelle, after my group, the Delphi's, had broken up. And William Stevenson, A&R director of Hitsville, USA, a new company that everybody was raving about, Berry Gordy Jr., turned this house into a studio. And I was singing at a place called the 20 Grand because I had won a contest. And I was using the name Martha Lavelle because that's the name my Aunt Bernice gave me when she pierced my ears. She sort of prophesied that I'd be famous at the age of 11. She did one hole in my ear, and I had to go to the bathroom. So she said, you're going to be famous. Name yourself Martha Lavelle. She even spelled it for me, L-A-V-A-I-L-L-E. And she passed away and never got to see that her prophesying paid off, because Mom was my biggest encouragement. In fact, when I'm on stage singing, I can hear her singing, sing it, baby, from the audience, because whenever she could, she'd come and watch us perform. I was singing at the 20 Grand, and William Stevenson gave me a card and said, come to Hitsville, USA, you have talent. I thought he was going to hit on me because he was so handsome. I thought he was my Prince Charming. So I quit my job at the dry cleaners and went there the next morning. And upon arrival, the same gentleman that had given me the card was in the same suit. He had rolled up his sleeves and taken his tie loose, had his jacket off, and he was writing a song for this drummer named Marvin Gaye. So he asked me what was I doing there? I said, what do you mean? I said, don't you remember giving me that card and asking me to come to this company? I started to turn around when I saw it was a house with a hand-painted sign. But Dad said, look for the 2400 block address, get off the bus and go in. So I had to think twice. I went inside, and when I saw him, after being buzzed through a little door, he said, what are you doing? I said, don't you remember giving me a card telling me to come here? He said, yeah, you're supposed to call for an appointment. We have auditions every third Thursday. Answer this phone, I'll be right back. Because this phone with four lines on it was just ringing off the hook. People were lined out on the front trying to get into Hitsville, USA. Well, I thought I was privileged because I got buzzed in the door, and I sat there for about 3 hours waiting on him to come back. I answered the phone, I answered the door. There were 17 writers, all in this one little cubbyhole of an office. And they were asking me who I was. I said, well, Mr. Stevenson said, you mean Mickey? I said, yeah. He said he'd be right back. And Freddie Gorman even came in. God rest his soul, we just lost him. He wrote Mr. Postman. He was one of the originals that sang I Hear the Bell, Marvin Gaye produced. I got a chance to meet Gladys Horton of the Marvelettes that day. I mean, a lot of things happened in those 3 hours. I met Benny Benjamin, the famous drummer of Motown, and James Jamerson. They came in very adamant about their money for the $5 session they had cut the day before. They wanted their Eminem money, you hear me? And the way they were talking, I got a little scared, so I called a lady in the sales department who asked me immediately, who are you? Oh, I'm Martha Reeves, I'm in the A&R department. And these gentlemen have a situation, they want their money. And they're sort of angry. And she said, well, we don't pay anybody until the end of the week. And they were still standing there cursing and mumbling, so I gave the phone directly to her. And about two or three sentences of their profanity and their demand for their pay, she said, put the A&R secretary back on the phone. So that officiated me. And I was there 9 months before I actually left that job to two girls from Secretarial College. Got on a broken down trailway without a toilet and rode on the first Motown Review, 94 One Nighters. And we stayed in one hotel, it was a Holiday Inn. We rode that bus from city to city. We were in the South, we got shot at. We were denied entrance to a lot of the restaurants. We learned how to go in the bush when they ran us off from that gas station with that shotgun. I saw my first double barrel shotgun in my face trying to get off the bus to use the facilities. And the man said, oh no, you're not using this restroom. Y'all get back on that bus and ride out of here. As the state troopers sped into the area and they dust coming to arrest us for coming there to try to use this restroom, that kind of thing. But a wonderful musical trip, because whenever we got to wherever we were going, the audiences just loved us.
I saw him kiss another and watched him hold her tight. And I made up in my mind that very night, I've got to let him go.
With all my love, I saw him.
turn on the radio, if it's synthesized music, if it's techno music, I can't listen to it. I wouldn't dare try to record with it. However, I made a statement that it was noisy toys that is dominating the industry right now. You can take one guy with a good Kurzweil, and he can sit there, he can play the drums and the piano and all that, but musicians taught me to sing. Listening to Sarah Vaughan and Ella Fitzgerald, who was the first female big band leader when her husband passed away. I've studied the history, and people like Billie Holiday, who musicians embraced to the point where she could be stoned out of her mind because of her lifestyle and what she chose to be, but they would embrace her, and she would come up with songs that make you just, your heart just bleed, and goosebumps, and all kinds of wonderful things happen to you when you hear the ladies I mentioned. I tried to emulate Dinah Washington for a while. She was superb as a musician as well as a singer. My sister, soul sister, Aretha Franklin, I saw her when she was 8 years old singing in her grandfather's church. So I know how important vocals are. And a lot of the youngsters today are having their voices manipulated. The people are missing the relationship between these guys who sat down and studied their instrument and appreciated and respected the singers enough to let them be heard like the Motown band did. All those guys were jazz musicians with learned degrees, and all of them could arrange. The producers were singers. That was the magic. Some of the Motown sound, how it was made. Those singers came in there and got with some learned professional musicians. The musicians were the backbone of the sound. So how can you disclude them? How can you say you're making music when there's not some professional professor sitting there showing you, this is an A, and this is a G, and this is how the chord progresses, this is a ninth on a chord. I mean, those are important things for a singer to know, especially as you mature in the business and you get a larger audience and you want to advance in your field. I was trained opera in high school, and I'm a public school student. And I think it's important that you should learn music. You should know how to read it and learn how to write it and learn where it started. Music has been important all of the history of the world. So how can you make music now? Maybe my sessions, I'm still using musicians, might cost me a good 10 grand, where today they can make a hit record in an hour and a half with one musician playing on a synthesizer. Doesn't have any feeling in it, doesn't give you any love, it just gives you tones. And you can go to a concert and the music's so loud until all you hear or feel is the thumping. And if you had a pacemaker, it probably could stop your heart. People are going to be deaf this generation. And they're not hearing tones, they're hearing sounds. Sounds, if you put somebody in a room and turn it up real loud, you could run them absolutely crazy.
The good thing about Motown was as a family, we never were rivals with ourselves, just other companies. I can remember being on shows with the Crystals and the Sorrells and the Ronettes and knowing that if it was Motown, if Motown was in it, Motown would win it. Our groups, the Temptations, the Contours, and the Spinners could compete with the other groups. And I'm sure they we took pride in them as our men. And Motown had a instruction called Artist Development, where we were all trained for 4 years with Professor Maxine Powell for personal development, Maurice King, and Johnny Allen for music theory. And we also had Charlie Atkins from Vaudeville, the team Colin Atkins. So we had a Motown look and a Motown pride that has lasted over the years. So it was a family, and it always will be.
Even amongst the girly groups, no competition, say, with the Supremes?
No, we had music first. There was no competition.
Nevertheless, I did read that that you said you became really good at nailing a song after the first take, because if you didn't, in that Motown factory, someone was always at the door ready to take your place.
At the front of your face, and they'll have this glass mirror like this one here, the glass wall, where someone would be standing there and say, if they can't nail it in one or two, give it to us. That was the Motown way. Barry would give the producers, all 17 of them, the task of writing a song for the next hot artist. And they would compete to the point where they'd all give him a example of what they would do for the artist. And he would call in people from the industry, people, clergymen, secretaries, waitresses, his friends from church. He would have them come and listen to the songs that the producers would provide for the next artist and ask them, would you buy this or would you rather buy a hot dog? And if they preferred to have the food as opposed to the record, it wouldn't be a hit. He considered their opinion as one to go with. And that's how our music was chosen.
It must have been incredibly dynamic there in that building. I mean, you were asked to come along and sing. You ended up answering the phones. But on an off day or when someone didn't turn up, then you slip into the studio and you provide backing vocals for some other famous Motown star.
Barry Gordy had a house with a hand-painted sign. When I arrived that day after being given a card and invited there, William Stevenson asked me, what was I doing there? And I said, don't you remember giving me this card last night? He had on the same suit. He hadn't even gone to bed. He was writing a song for this drummer named Marvin Gaye. And he asked me to answer the phone because it was ringing off the hook. He wanted to go off to somewhere, maybe at the office of the president, to finish this session so he could provide Marvin Gaye with his first big hit, Something Kind of Fella. And he was gone for 3 hours. In those 3 hours, I answered the phone. I took messages. And I had a commercial course in high school.
And you just walked in the door and sat down and started taking over.
Well, I asked, you know, whenever I'm asked to speak at schools, I encourage the youngsters to stay in school and get as much education as I can, because had I not had a commercial course in high school, I would have known to answer the phone, A&R secretary, may I help you? Who is this? There's no A&R secretary. Yes, there is. My name is Martha Reeves, and may I help you? Where's Mickey? You mean Mr. Stevenson? He said he'd be right back. So there's a rapport, and I had it, you know, only because I paid attention in school. Everything I've ever learned, I've had to use in school, from school. So I encourage the youngsters, whoever wants to be successful in life, everything you learn, you use.
I'm
to be successful in life, and back then to starting out, you really had to go all the time. Some of your first tours with Motown, you're on the road for 94 days straight.
Yes, yes.
Do you have good memories of that time, or was it just hard work?
It was good memories, because it was like being at a day camp with a lot of talented youngsters. I remember Stevie Wonder, just 8 years old, walking through the bus as it was rumbling along. It was a broken down trailway with no toilet. Stevie would go, and if anyone was snoring, he'd snap him. Pop him in the face. Because he was an 8-year-old child who should have been out somewhere playing, but he was on a tour bus with all these talented people, a 12-piece orchestra, the Marvelettes, the Temptations were singing behind Mary Wells at the time, the Miracles. It was just wonderful to be on Marvin Gaye, the Marvelettes with Mr. Postman. And we were all young, but all talented.
All that talent in one bus.
On one bus.
And mm-hmm. living in midst all that talent.
Yes.
Do you think that made you a better artist?
It made us a company and a family of hitmakers. I was a good artist when I went there. I had recorded prior to Motown, and I was trained in the church. So I had my legs about me. I knew that I was just a messenger, and I had the gift. And I think Barry only chose people who had the gift, who were actually proteges, who had either grown up in the church or had singing families. I think that's what it was. Most of the people that came to Motown had already recorded or were ready to record or had sang in the church, like Stevie Wonder. He was discovered 8 years old in a Pentecostal church directing a choir from a Hammond organ.
Marvin Gaye was a drummer, a session drummer who wore a hat over his eyes and kept a pipe in his mouth and sunglasses, so you couldn't really tell how handsome he was. And he was called on sessions. Well, he was a singer when he got there, but no one knew because he was such an introvert. And he needed backup singers. So we recorded Stubborn Kind of Fella. The next time we were called in, we did Hitchhike and Pride and Joy. So we were the first girls at Motown to actually accompany Marvin Gaye.
What is this business about you providing human sound effects when you were working in the office at Motown?
Pride and Joy, we clapped all the way through that thing. If you listen to it, you hear these hand claps.
Yeah, those are your hands.
Those are our hands, yes. Actually, Marvin and the Vandellas at first.
Marvin and the Vandellas.
Before our record hit, yes.
I never knew that. Over the years, though, people really didn't get to know the Vandellas that well as individuals. Those names don't stick in our collective memories the way Martha Reeves does. How do you feel about that?
I feel good about it because there's been over 100 Vandellas, and I'm always looking for willing spirits.
Love for you, gone from me and left behind so many memories.
That was a song that Barry declared the Motown sound, the
Barry
sound
Gordy.
That he had been looking for, had been working for, had been drilling musicians and mixing in the studio. He finally found the sound that he was looking for.
And what was it about Come and Get These Memories that made Barry Gordy say, that's it, that's what I'm looking for?
He was a perfectionist. He wanted everything to be exactly how he thought it should be. And because of his taste and his ingenuity, we all came out winners.
Love you.
Gone from me and left behind.
that one actually was not recorded during a heat wave, was it?
No. No, but the newscaster in Los Angeles, Network News, announced a heat wave with our record and broke it nationwide for us. Heat wave was about 3 weeks old when it was released. Motown had finally found this machine that could put a record out in 3 weeks. The minute we recorded Heat Wave, it was on the air.
Thank you.
Were you surprised at the reaction to Dancing in the Street?
Yes, because at first I didn't like it. Marvin didn't like it. So I'm wondering, why would they have me sing this?
Oh, well, you mean they wouldn't have given it to you if it was really, Marvin, really good material?
If Marvin had liked it, he would have kept it for himself. He would have had the hit with it. But you never know. You go in the studio, you don't actually say in your mind, I'm going to record a million seller, but you pray that you do. It took the world by storm. It caused a lot of controversy. A lot of people thought it was something other than what the words were actually saying. But all it says is, calling out around the world, are you ready for a brand new beat? Let's dance in the street, doesn't matter what you wear. That's what the song is all about, and you can't read anything into that.
A lot of people did talk about that as being some sort of new black anthem.
Yeah. That didn't say anything about blacks either, did it?
Nope.
Just said, come and party, and that's a universal thing.
It's got to be the most covered Motown song of all time, I think. What's your favorite cover of Dancing in the Street?
I could say that Mamas and the Papas, Mama Cass, was my first experience as having someone copy your song. But she did such a good job of it. And I remember standing in a television station with her, and a youngster walked up to two of us standing there talking and loving one another and said, who sang it first? And she literally jumped on the kid. She says, how dare you not know that it was Martha Reeves and the Vandellas first? So I loved her, and I think she did a good job. But there have been people like Neil Diamond who has done Dancing in the Street, and The Who did a version of it, and David Lee Roth with Van Halen, Brenda Lee recorded it, Dusty Springfield recorded it.
I'm waiting to see if you turn up your lips at any, turn up your nose at any of them, any you didn't like so much.
I loved all of that. That's only a compliment when somebody like Mick Jagger and Dave Bowie, you know, actually making all that money for the AIDS Foundation and going to number one when I didn't. They only claimed me number two with that song. I know it went to number one, but they didn't want to tell me that, I guess. I remember Mick Jagger in the 60s when we played Ready, Steady, Go. They were just the Rolling Stones at that time, and the Beatles were on the show with the Pretty Things and Lulu and the Lovers. And I remember being there together. So when they remembered my song, it was like, thank you. They remembered me. And I felt it a compliment.
Oh,
about Nowhere to Run.
There's a gospel song called I Went to the Rock to Hide My Face. The rocks cried out, no hiding place, no hiding place, nowhere to run. Was used a lot in Vietnam. And it was also played in Good Morning Vietnam. Robin Williams put it on the turntable and called our name out and played it in Good Morning Vietnam.
Well, here's a song coming your way right now, Nowhere to Run to by Martha and the Vandellas. Yes! Hey, you know what I mean!
And it still let everybody know that a lot of the soldiers felt they had nowhere to run during that war. It was big during that particular time.
I don't know.
Well, talking about I Made It So Can You, did you ever think when you were touring with the Vandellas in the 60s that, you know, you'd ever live to see the day where there'd be a black president of the United States?
Never. You know, but then I don't see him as a black president. I see him as a person representing America. Now I feel it's united.
Do you think he's doing a good job?
I know he is, because the economy has changed, and we had our best year in 3 years in Detroit economically. They proclaimed it after Christmas that sales were up. Our car manufacturers are standing on their feet after their government perk that they got. People are starting to feel that life can be happy again. We went through a recession, and no one wanted to call it that. But, you know, foreclosures and the people are leaving the city of Detroit, population going from 3 million to 900,000 to 450,000. Was proof that there was something wrong. Too many taxes, not enough break for the citizens, and taxes overwhelmingly unfair. As a politician, I was able to change a few of those things and get a few breaks for small businesses, and to the point of having, like, okay, for instance, I changed an ordinance where a resident, if they want to foreclose on someone and set them out in the street, don't put it on the berm, put it in a garbage can. If people don't come and get their belongings in 2 or 3 days, take it to the junkyard as opposed to letting kids play in it, let dogs and birds and everything have access to their discarded furniture, things like that. And it was important to me. And I had a lot of influence, mainly because I'm a public figure. I was famous before I got on the council.
You're still performing. What keeps you there?
Berry Gordy wanted to make the sound of young America. And I can feel as young as I felt when I first sang Come and Get These Memories or Love is Like a Heat Wave or Jimmy Mac. There's a certain youth implement in the music. The Funk Brothers taught us to sing. They were the backbone of the Motown sound. We accredit a lot of our success to the actual fact that these were jazz musicians who lended their talents to us and let us be heard. Today, you might have a little difficulty hearing the singers over the bass guitar or over the drums or the loud guitars. Motown had a jazz concept and turned it into rhythm and blues. And basically gospel music was derived from, well, it was derived from gospel music. There's a lot of, you know, things that were put into the Motown sound, but it was basically it's love songs that put people together.
One thing that you don't have trouble hearing today in a lot of contemporary music, a lot of R&B music today, is the influence of Motown, the Motown sound. If Motown was the sound of young America then, is it a sound for young Americans and, you know, young people now still?
Oh, no. They've stopped using live musicians. There are a lot of noisy toys that you're listening to. You don't know whether there's an instrument or whether this is a keyboard with a different tone or different button pushed. The musicians made us sing. They gave us inspiration. There was a time when there were just big bands and they didn't really necessarily need singers, like the days of Billy Holiday and Billy Eckstein and Count Basie. They had a singer, but the bands were featured. Then they started listening to singers and letting them come into the actual studio or on the stage to sing and start recording. Then it changed up where you got a lot of musicians who would play jazz, but they would back away like the Motown Funk Brothers and let the singers be heard. Today, you don't have musicians inspiring the singers, so you got a lot of noisy toys making music, and people are sounding alike. You don't know one girl from the other. You don't know one group from another. You don't know what they're saying. If they're inspiring somebody to do anything, I hope it's not to destroy each other or to burn somebody's house down or kill the police or take your clothes off, it's getting hot in here, things like that.
Now, Martha, you don't think you're sounding just a bit like the older generation?
I am the older generation. I have had the criticism from older people as long as I've been a performer. But I think what I'm saying, it's good for anyone who has an interest in business, in the show business, because music is the key.
Tries to
This musical journey you've been on for so many decades, you stepped away for a minute to enter the world of politics. In 2005, you got elected as a Detroit city councillor. Why did you do that?
Well, music had slowed down a little bit for us. You see, burlesque came back into R&B. A lot of the young girls were taking things off that they told me I could sing as long as I keep my clothes on. And so the music slowed down a little bit for us, and I looked around. I had been going to the different schools and encouraging the youngsters. I do have a seminar that I present, and my theme is I Made It, So Can You, to encourage those who have talent to stay in school, to learn what the profession is, to learn to read music, to learn to write music and play music in order to be in this business, because you have to do it all. And someone said, well, you know, you're doing civic duty. Why don't you go throw your hat in the political ring? And I said, well, why not? I'm not working as much as I'd like to. My son is grown. I have 3 grandchildren. The city needs someone to speak for the seniors, which I am. And I was able to visit a lot of the retirement homes and a lot of the convalescent homes and talk to the seniors. A lot of people take their mothers and fathers and grandmothers and grandfathers to homes and just leave them there. There should be someone to communicate with them. And I did that as a personal thing. I took on the needs and the wants of the seniors. And I did change a lot of things. I went to a couple of the facilities and found bed bugs. I went to another couple of facilities where when they went in the day room, if it rained, the ceiling leaked on them. I had a lot of things improved. I had street names changed. There was a 2648 West Grand Boulevard is now 2648 Berry Gordy Boulevard. You know, I want
to put statues. Tipping your hat to Motown.
Yes, I want to put statues there. I don't have to be on the council to do that. But I did 4 years of civic duty. And I want you to know that I'd prefer to being around entertainers as opposed to politicians.
You're shiftless and you're lazy, just like that hound dog Daisy I had when Grandma raised me. Honey child, quit granny. Got too old to scorn me. Dear old auntie warned me. You sure was no good for me, honey child. But your kisses
Jimmy Mack was during the Vietnam War. We had to wait until the war calmed before it could be released. So that was the one that was kept in the can for 4 years before they released it.
Why?
The war was a serious war. And Jimmy Mack is kind of lighthearted. It kind of like, you know, mimics somebody marching straight four beat. And it was too lighthearted for the seriousness of the war.
So in the heyday there of the 60s, you're out on the road, you're doing television shows, you're getting lessons, you have recording sessions.
Yes.
Did you have time for life?
Yes, I had time for life. I had time to get sort of messed up on drugs, too. And I took a little spill, but I'm a survivor.
Were you a victim of just a lot of success at a young age?
I was a victim of wanting to be in the in crowd.
And everybody was doing it.
That's what you do. That's how you get in the party. If you don't do that, you don't even get invited.
If you weren't as headstrong a woman as you were,
I would never have made it.
There are some who say you would have even gone further in Motown.
I haven't reached my peak, and I don't think I want to, because the only place that you go after you reach the top of the mountain is downhill. So there's always some newness. I've got some things that I really want to do. There's some things that I want to receive, some awards I want to receive, and I want to earn them. And I guess I'm in the right direction, and most of my dreams have come true. I got a few more, and I want to see those through before I leave this earth.